Today, we have first keynote address by Professor B.M. Hegde. To chair this session, I'll invite Professor Raju. He is a senior professor and HOD of Department of Neurophysiology and also the patron of this APPICON 2003. Now, I'll request Dr. Raju to introduce B.M. Hegde and start the first session. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, everybody. What a rare privilege indeed is to chair Professor Hegde's keynote address. Professor Belle Monappa Hegde is a physician par excellence. If I say that, at best it would be an understatement. An astute clinician and a teacher in the true guru tradition. Throughout his tenure as a medical student at Stanley Medical College, Madras, I must say, I was pleased to know this morning the father-in-law of my aunt, Professor Vaidyanatha Iyer, Professor of Medicine at Stanley Medical College, was his teacher. Needless to say, he was a brilliant student. He did his MD from Lucknow University after his undergraduate. He was supported by a scholarship by Government of India. Subsequently, he went to England on prestigious Commonwealth Fellowship and passed the membership of Royal College of Physicians of UK. He then underwent advanced training in cardiology at Harvard Medical School, a great place to be there. I was there for a couple of years. He was trained under Nobel laureate Bernard Lawn. He is now the fellow of all Royal Colleges and the American College of Cardiology. Professor Hegde started his teaching career in 1962 in Manipal. He then served in the Kasturba Medical College, Mangalore, and Manipal for nearly 5 decades, occupying with distinction the posts of Professor of Medicine, Director PG Studies, Principal, Dean, Pro Vice Chancellor, and ultimately the coveted post of Vice Chancellor of Manipal University. Professor Hegde, as you would anticipate, is a recipient of numerous national and international awards. Due to paucity of time, I would name just a few. Dr. B.C. Roy National Award for being an eminent medical teacher, Dr. J.C. Bose Award for Life Science Research, Pride of India Award from the US, Distinguished Physician of India Award from APA, Healer of Mankind Award from Symbiosis University, Pune, Vaidya Ratnakara Award, Karnataka Rajyotsava Award, among many others. Professor Hegde has written 35 books and over 3,000 articles in lay press. During the last decade, Professor Hegde, along with 15 world-renowned scientists, some of them are indeed Nobel laureates, have been publishing a journal titled Journal of the Science of Healing Outcomes, of which he is the founder editor. Professor Hegde's service to the society was recognized through by the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. And we know his activity is legendary. In 2010, Professor B.M. Hegde was conferred with the prestigious Padma Bhushan Award by the President of India. He was also awarded honorary doctorate degree by the Venkateshwara Institute of Medical Sciences. What more can I say? We are really fortunate to have Professor Hegde to deliver the keynote address for our conference. Thank you so much, sir.
To kindly come on the dais.
Outstanding delegates are inside. Can I make an appeal to the outstanding delegates to come in, please? Quite a few of them are there. And why have all the delegates chosen to sit in the back benches? Because I still remember when I joined as a junior teacher, I had a very strict dean in the medical school. He called me and said, young boy, take care of two sets of students in the class, the last benches and the front benches. Rest of them will look after themselves, he said. I didn't have the courage to ask him why he said what he said. 10 years later, he was retiring. And in the farewell meeting, I asked him, sir, you said this to me 10 years ago. I couldn't ask you at that time. Tell me why it is so. So do you know what he said, the backbenchers? He said, look after the backbenchers because they have not come here to study. They have come here to enjoy life, get a degree, and become politicians soon. And they'll be ministers, your bosses, so be careful of them. The front benchers are the muggers. They will mug up every word in the textbook and pass the exam very fast and become your colleagues, junior colleagues. Look after them because having a bad junior colleague is very difficult in life. Very, very sound advice. And I always look at the backbenchers with a little suspicion. What are they here for? Anyway, friends, I must at the outset thank Lakshmi Rao, whom I had seen only this morning. You would be surprised. She had not seen me either. And how did she trust me to give a keynote? God only knows. But she was insisting. She was like a, you know, leech. We use leech in treatment. The leech bites you and sucks your blood, but doesn't hurt you at all. She wouldn't take a no for an answer. And thank you, Lakshmi, for having me here. I'm very happy to talk to physiologists, whom I consider as the most important teachers in the medical school. My only sorrow was, when we were all students, those who couldn't get any other area and those who had taken a long time to pass MBBS, these are very experienced people in the medical school. They used to take to physiology, anatomy and all. Things are changing now. Bright boys and girls are taking to physiology and anatomy. Because my concept, a physiologist must be a professor of medicine. He must teach from day one till you die, if he can teach you. Because after all, it's physiology. That's the whole thing is physiology. And what is disease? Altered physiology, that's all. There's nothing else. So physiology is important, and we must have brilliant physiologists. I hope India will in future have brilliant physiologists. The one way you can attract them is be very good teachers. A teacher is a role model for a student. And if you have a brilliant teacher like Kutti, and then they say, I should be like Kutti, that's where they become physiologists. So we all used to have role models in our teachers. And he said, those were the days when we said, I must be someone like him or her. And today it's not like that. Today the boys and girls want which specialty gets you more money quicker so that you can have a lot of money. That's the change, sea change there. I still remember the days when we were even abroad for that matter. In the canteen and all, you sit and people talk, I love ophthalmology, I love physiology, I love this, I want to do. Today you go there. They say, hey, it's better to have ophthalmology than cardiac surgery because one surgery takes about 14 hours and then no sleep in the night. And in the time, you can do about 10 cataracts and get 10 times the money that the cardiac surgeon gets. So I want to be an ophthalmologist. And now the latest craze is I want to be a diagnostic radiologist. In the olden days, we used to call them photographers. Even physiology, then they become radiologists. Today, no, they're the first because you are an interventional radiologist. You get tons of money. You know the meaning of the word interventional? No. There are three meanings for that in the Webster's dictionary. The third one is very important. Intervene, it means go in between with malice. That is the intervention that we do. The divine interventionists tell people that I can do anything and I can correct everything. Unfortunately, the end result, you know, the number of people who go home horizontal vis-a-vis vertical has not changed from 1900 to 2013. Did you know that? No, there was an audit at Christie's in Manchester, one of the oldest and probably the best cancer hospital to date. They have records from 1841. Somebody recently wanted to see what's happening with all our recent treatment. They took one disease, chronic myeloid leukemia, and took two slots, 1900, 1940, 1950, 1990, all 40-year slots. In the first half, we had one treatment, TLC. You know TLC? Tender loving care. In the second half, we had so many things, busulfan, this, that, splenectomy, what have you. But unfortunately, the audit showed in the second half, more people died because of us. This is a sad story. And today, going to the hospital, people get frightened for two reasons. A, they should have a big bank balance or must have a rich father-in-law. Otherwise, you can't go to a hospital today. It's so difficult. And an American audit, very interesting audit. I want you all to read, because we always think American medicine is great and we want to ape it and we do research that's called Me Too research, copycat research, all American. And do you know the audit in America? The medical establishment is the leading cause of death, followed by cancer low down and heart attack still lower down. And among the medical establishment, the most important leading cause of death, the pharmacologists are here, right? Drugs. Adverse drug reaction. Oliver Wendell Holmes, who was teaching in Harvard, teaching anatomy in Harvard, wrote a small note. He said, if the whole materia medica, there's a medical box, could be sunk to the bottom of the seas, it'll be that much good for fishes and that much worse for man, that much good for mankind and that much worse for the fishes. This he wrote in the 18th century when there were very few drugs, hardly half a dozen drugs. Today we have millions of drugs. And you can imagine what's happening to mankind today. I'm going to talk to you on a different subject altogether. I have been working on a hypothesis saying that we are following the wrong science in medicine, in biology. Biology has been looking for a holy grail without success even today. You're all biologists, basically, physiologists or biologists. How many of you have read this beautiful book called Submolecular Biology? Introduction to Submolecular Biology. This was written by a Nobel laureate biologist, Albert Zent Gyorgy. I want you people to read that book. That will open your eyes because what we are doing is what is called reductionist science. Linear mathematics. Higher the blood pressure, the quicker you die. Higher the sugar, the quicker you die. And do you want to know? MR fit study is the longest study of risk factor intervention, multiple risk factor intervention trial, Mr. Fit, MRFIT, which spent $110 million. Went on for 25 years now. Started with 500,000 Americans screened to get 100,000 Americans for the study. And the study, to cut it short, says today that there is nothing called risk factor at all. You can reduce somebody's blood pressure, you can reduce somebody's sugar, you can reduce somebody's cholesterol, you can reduce everything, his height, weight, everything you can do. But you can't change the risk. What is the risk? Premature death, precocious death, disease. The disease, if anything, has increased after we intervened. Why? Because we always do what is called surrogate endpoint research. I have taken the blood pressure. I will tell you about the physiology of blood pressure a little later. Then I have given a drug, which is a chemical. Hello? Inchaller. Given a drug, the blood pressure has come down. You're so happy. You're very happy. See, the blood pressure has come down. I have a study. I've shown. I'll present. What happened to the patient? Nobody bothers. Patient has probably met his maker a little earlier than he would have otherwise. This is the sorry state of affairs. This is a sorry state of affairs. This should change. If that should change, we should seriously think about a new science for medicine. How many of you understood when I said reductionist science? Good, good. I'm very happy. Because 3 days ago, I was lecturing in a very important medical college and talking to staff of the medical college. Not one medical college, 3 medical colleges of the university. And it's morphology. And what is morphology? Albert Zend-Gyorgy, in his book, Introduction to Submolecular Biology, says, I don't know what cancer is. Because a cancer cell works exactly like a normal cell. But it may look different in the tombstone. So a cancer cell works exactly like a normal cell. I don't know of any treatment which can kill a cancer cell without killing a normal cell. So friends, chocolate is not sugar. Chocolate is not cocoa. And so human body is not liver, spleen, kidney, brain, heart, lung, or leg. Human body is human body. Human body, this is our evidence. Somebody got a Nobel Prize for showing this evidence and saying that the earth is warming. Now the present science shows we are going into an ice age, second ice age. Become cooler, a lot cooler. Now only evidence for the earth being warm is the underwear of ladies. 18th century, it was very big. Now it is hardly seen. This is called surrogate evidence. That's exactly what we are doing in research. We have thousands and thousands and thousands of papers. There was a professor of physiology and cardiology in Stanford. His name is John Ioannidis. John was a very peculiar chap. He is a wizard in mathematics. So he went to investigate published papers in 6 leading journals. Not ordinary journals. Not Japi, Gipi and all. The top journals. And do you know what he came up with? 85% of what is written there is not worth even reading second time. Of course, it's not correct. And he came to the conclusion that almost 95% of what we doctors do is not based on science. So much so, what has happened next, you see. Today, a patient is running away from the hospital. Have you seen this? This is from the Time magazine. Patient is running away because as soon as he went into the hospital and said chest, before he said pain, 6 surgeons were ready with knife to do a bypass surgery. So he said, the only way is, if you want to survive, you simply say no and run away in the hospital gown itself. And you see all these corporate hospital fellows, from the superintendent to the nurse, are running after him. Because if you don't have a patient, I always tell my students, a doctor can never survive without patients, but a patient can survive without doctors, probably better. So that's what has happened now. This has come to that. Because see, this is what's happening. You go to the hospital. 1 week ago, I saw a patient in Chennai. Very interesting chap. He had some little difficulty in breathing at night. Everybody gets frightened because you see now what is called a medical scare system. Every 5 minutes in the television, you see the heart doing that and some oil. He said, heart healthy oil. Go for a checkup tomorrow. This is the biggest fraud on mankind. And with this, everybody gets frightened. So this fellow went to the hospital. Immediately, they took an ECG. Incidentally, the ECG was normal. But they told him, you had a heart cardiac arrest. You had a cardiac arrest. This man is walking to the hospital. Then they said, where are your relatives and all? Because get all of them, because something serious is happening. So got all the relatives, looked at them, how well they are, where is their bank balance. First, they asked him whether you have insurance, whether you're a government servant, whether you're, you know, in the corporate sector. When they said, nothing, get your relatives. And he saw one relative was very, then he said, immediately he must have an angiogram and then an angioplasty. He may not even go home alive. He went home walking. So this is what is happening to our hospitals. Do we have a science of man as of now? Have you heard of this Nobel laureate who taught surgeons how to stitch vessels? His name is Alexis Carrel. Have you heard of him? He has written a book called Man the Unknown. One sentence there is worth reading. He says, there is no science of man today, full stop. And I've been saying this for 50 years now. Modern medicine needs a new science. Modern medicine needs a new scientific model. Now, what are we doing all this time? What have we been doing? RCTs and peer review. What is RCT? Randomized controlled trial. What are you controlling? Two groups of human beings. Now, these two human beings are not alike at all. They are not molecules in the laboratory to be compared. They are two different human beings. They are two different consciousness, two different minds. And I'll tell you eventually, you are a mind, you are not the body. Body is an illusion. In quantum physics, body is an illusion. So how can you compare two comparatively disparate groups and say, I've compared the two, this group is better than this group, so this treatment is better than that treatment. That's why every treatment now kills more people than it saves. Next one is, this is a real bane. What's called? Peer review. Ah, what a beautiful thing. What is peer review? Do you know what peer review is? Yes? He is his own friend. Good, good. He is very good, very good. Peer review is a Western scientific trick to see that knowledge does not go forwards. Oh, you didn't know that? Karl Popper. Have you heard of Karl Popper? Good. Karl Popper is a physicist, and he was the professor of science philosophy in the London School of Economics in the 50s as a colossus. He had written so many books. One book he writes, knowledge advances not by repeating known facts, but by refuting false dogmas. Did you understand that? Now, what does the peer review say? Supposing I say there is no science of man and I publish a paper. Peer reviewer says, this is nonsense. Don't publish it. So only known things can be published. That's called peer-reviewed journal. Actually, RCT and peer review are supposed to be the highest things, no? Only the other day, the president of NICE, you know NICE, National Institute of Clinical Excellence, this is the highest body of science in the UK. Sir Michael Rollins was giving an oration at the Royal College. He said, I quote, RCTs and peer review have been put on a very high, undeserving pedestal. That's why science is not progressing. Can you believe that? I was giving a talk in the Indian Institute of Science 10 years ago when Abdul Kalam wanted me to give a keynote address in the Science Congress. I told him, I'm not accepted as a scientist by your scientist groups. He said, don't worry, I'll tell them. And when I was talking, they thought I'm talking, you know, through my hat. Now they write to me, yes, what did you say that time? I want that reference, I want this reference. 10 years later. This is the bane of our science, anyway. Now the last thing that we are killing patients in our physiology is one size fits all. That is what's called normal blood pressure. What is that, normal blood pressure? Your physiologist. I don't know. Gandhiji's blood pressure was 200 by 120 all his life. And who was losing sleep? Sushila Nair. Old man was sleeping nicely. And Gandhiji died of a very important complication of high blood pressure, bullet. His kidneys were all right, his brain was all right, his heart was all right, his vessels were all right, because his mind was all right. He didn't hate nobody. It is if you hate somebody only you get disease. Did you know that? Hostility is the most important risk factor of heart attack and cancer. Anger is the cause of cerebral hemorrhage. Not eating cholesterol or anything like that. Actually, for cholesterol, more the barrier. The more you have, the longer you live, because you have very strong wall in the cell. So our problem is one size fits all. Everybody must be 120 by 80. And we call this as, in physiology, we call it as normal. Is there a definition of normal? This is average, average. There's a different, big difference between normal and average. I'll give you an example for the younger generation. Average Indian height is male height is 5.4 plus minus 2 inches. Gaussian curve, mean plus 2 standard deviation, all the things that you write for all papers. Now imagine Amitabh Bachchan comes for a checkup. He's absolutely abnormal, 6.2. Our treatment is cut his leg, make him 5.6. Don't laugh, that's what we are doing in hypertension and diabetes also. I can tell you, your first director here, I've been seeing him for 45 years, his blood pressure is always 90 by 40. So he'll come and say, Endu cheya? Endu cheya? I told him, don't cheya anything, you'll be there forever. You'll never die. This is the problem. So, Jaya Bachchan comes for a checkup. 4.6. She's the ideal candidate for transplanting that leg because she'll also become 5.6. This is exactly what you and I do in our science, my dear friends. You may laugh today, but go home and seriously think about it tonight. You will not get sleep. Hippocrates wrote, not today, disease is not an entity. Remember that? But a fluctuating condition of the patient's body, a battle between substance, disease, and the natural self-healing tendency of the body. What a fascinating 21st century definition of disease. Today we know the diseases that we teach our students, heart disease, lung disease, head disease, leg disease, has gone out of date. And the treatment of that is either under-treatment, over-treatment, or mistreatment. You don't believe me, because you know, Indians, that too I'm from a village. I'll give you an American reference. Anyone, pencil, pen? The end of the disease era. The article's name is End of the Diseased Era. The author is Mary Tinetti. Tinetti, T-I-N-N-E-T-T-I. Young man is writing there. And of course, William Steed, her assistant. Two of them wrote. They are from Yale, not from ordinary university, Yale University. And this is in the American Journal of Medicine, 2004. Somebody is writing there. Write down, volume 116. And page 179. She shows there that we have been killing people left, right, and center by treating them for these things. Lowering somebody's blood pressure, doing some bypass surgery, doing some angioplasty, that too, blasting the endothelium. You are living here because of the endothelium. Endothelial relaxing factor, EDRF, nitric oxide. And you damage it, no EDRF. So only EDCF, it'll contract. But who bothers? We are all lost in reductionist science. Statistical science and not a hard science, what you and I are doing. Reductionist treats the human body as a mechanical machine run by its electrobiochemistry. You talk to a biochemist, he thinks only biochemistry runs the whole world. Quick fix methods for damage control. Somebody's potassium is 3.3, immediately you give potassium. Little do we know that what is called transmutation, biological transmutation. If your body really needs potassium, it can convert sodium into potassium. Fascinating thing. It's called biological transmutation, a science which developed enormously in Russia, but kept out of the American orbit because they didn't want this science because there is no business in it. Even today, we don't know how to treat a patient in the intensive care unit. Suppose he has lost blood. Point, drop by drop, you replace it, he'll die. Because there is what is called auto-transfusion and auto-infusion in the body, depending on the need. There are about 500 cc of blood in the pelvis. And when somebody meets with an accident and bottle of blood gone, that blood will get into the circulation. It gets pumped back. It is in that pool. This body, human body, if you are 60 kilograms body, you've got about 8 lakhs kilometers of capillaries. They hold so much of blood. We'll come to that later. Now, the latest science says E is equal to M. So E is equal to MC squared is all gone, long gone, but we still teach that in our schools. This has come in 1925, but refined now by a man called Hans Peter Dürer, the double Nobel laureate, who is the emeritus director of Max Planck Institute. I'll show him to you. He is the co-editor-in-chief of our journal. And Hans calls this as A-duality. That means there is no two things. Matter is energy, energy is matter. You have simple article he has written for you to read. Don't read all that physics. Write down, matter is not made out of matter. Matter is not made out of matter. This is the Google. His name is Hans, H-A-N-S, Peter, P-E-T-R. Dürer, D-U-R-R. And this article, he tells you that I am a child playing with small things in the periphery, calling it A-duality. The Indian sages called it as Advaita, Sat, Sat. And here is a German who doesn't even know English properly, quotes Sanskrit. You go to his laboratory, he has got all the scriptures, Indian scriptures there. And he quotes the Upanishads that said what energy and matter is. Bahir antas cha bhutanam. It is outside and inside of everything. Charam, it's moving. But acharam, you look solid, nothing solid, you're moving. You're jumping leptocoxs a bit. Charam acharamevate. Sukshmavate tavidneyam. It is so subtle, no microscope, no endoscope, no telescope can understand that. Only mindoscope can understand that. We don't have it. And what does he say? Durastam. You don't know? You don't know. Cha, aniketa cha. When you know, it is very close. Tat, tat, sat. Matter and energy. Human body works as a whole. Please remember this one sentence. Mug it up. Remug it up. Human body works as a whole. Heart doesn't work in isolation. So heart failure is not a disease of cardiology. Heart disease is a physiology. Heart disease has got so many problems. Starting from the muscle, to the brain, to the heart, to the lungs. But the key is held in the muscle. Chronic heart failure, the key is held in the muscle. And it's the muscle that gives you what you want to do. Human body is but a bundle of energy. Human body is but a bundle of energy. Why human body? The whole universe is immaterial. Human body is a material. This fellow is a, he didn't get his Nobel Prize, but he's tipped for that. Richard Con Henry is a professor of physics in Johns Hopkins. And he wrote this. The universe is immaterial, mental and spiritual, live and enjoy. I have slightly changed it. Human body is immaterial, mental and spiritual, live and enjoy. So this human body is a wisdom, enormous wisdom. Many times we feel this patient should die, according to our textbook. But next day you see him, he's smiling in the ward, and third day is walking out. Many times these patients will probably outlive the doctor and go for their funeral rounds. All this is possible because you can't predict the future, there's no future. Modern medical science has no place for keeping man either healthy or alive. Did you read that? Modern medicine has no place to either keep man healthy or alive. Need for a new science of man. But I'll give you one small example. Stem cell. I met somebody who said, I'm in genetics. You know, big genetics. What is this genetics? Genes are nothing. How many genes do you have in the chromosome? 23,000 to 25,000. But do you know how many germ genes you have? 2.5 trillion. In a metagenome, you have 2.5 trillion genes. So you manipulate these 23,000 genes and then say, I'm producing a stem cell and give it inside, it'll go to do something else. Because the genes have no power. Gene expression, the protein expression, which is called gene penetrance, depends on the environment. And what is the environment? Outside it was in vitro, it was your environment. Laboratory, test tube, whatever. Inside, the environment is the mind, human mind. And there, it works in a different way altogether. But body produces stem cells. They're called endogenous stem cells. How body produces stem cells? You'll be shocked. You and I don't live long beyond 100 years. But our rishis and munis and people, Hunsrus and others in Uzbekistan, they live 120 years. Why? We have too much oxygen here. There is very little oxygen there. Oxygen is one of the biggest problems for us, too much oxygen. In the olden days, when somebody got a heart attack when I was a student, and later on also, we used to immediately give oxygen. Now we know we have killed millions of people by giving oxygen when the man gets a heart attack. You need hypoxia at that time. Now I have developed something to produce hypoxia for all of you every day so that you will live long like Hunsrus. If at the end, if there is time, and if Lakshmi permits, you ask a question, I'll show you how to live long. High altitude living is good. It encourages preconditioning in the various organs like the heart. When you give hypoxia, it is like pension. When you retire, you get less money, so you have to know how to live with this money. So you teach it earlier when you are when you are the professor of physiology and the head of the director of the Institute of Physiology and things like that. Then you know how to live with less money. After you retire, you are very happy. But when you are in the top, you enjoy it. And then suddenly you retire, you feel like a bit suicide. Stimulus erythropoietin. Now we can study the cells. Human body ಅಣ್ಣ ಒಂದು ಲೋಟ ನೀರು ತರ್ತೀಯ, ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಒಂದು ಬಾಟ್ಲಿ ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಹುಡುಗ. ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಈಸ್ ಅ ಕಾಲನಿ. ಯು ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಐ ಆರ್ ಎ ಕಾಲನಿ ಆಫ್ 100 trillion ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ಹೂ ಆರ್ ದೇ? ಸೆಲ್ಸ್. ಈಚ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬೀಯಿಂಗ್. ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಮೈಂಡ್, ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಇಟ್ ಡಸ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬಿನ್ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಎ ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಯೂನಿಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ನಂಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಯರ್ಸ್, ನಂಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಯರ್ಸ್, ಮಿಲಿಯನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಯರ್ಸ್. ದೆನ್ ದೇ ಥಾಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಇಕನಾಮಿಕ್ ರೀಸನ್ಸ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಮನಮೋಹನ್ ಸಿಂಗ್ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಟಾಟ್ ದೆಮ್ ಸಮ್ ಇಕನಾಮಿಕ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ದೇ ಸೆಡ್ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್, ವೈ ಆಲ್ ಲಿವ್ ಎಲೋನ್ ಎಲೋ ಇನ್ನೋ ಇನ್ನೋ. ಸೊ ದೇ ಕೇಮ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್. ವೆನ್ ದೇ ಕೇಮ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ದೇ ವಿ ಕಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಅಸ್ ಎ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬಾಡಿ. ದೆನ್ ವೆನ್ ದೇ ಕೇಮ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ದೇ ಸೆಡ್ ವೈ ಶುಡ್ ಎವ್ರಿಬಡಿ ಡೂ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಡೇ? ಸೊ ದೇ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್, ಸೇ ಫ್ಯೂ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್, ಏ ಯು ಡೂ ದ ವರ್ಕ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ನೋ ಲುಕಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ದ ಆಲ್ ದ ನರ್ವಸ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್, ಕಾಲ್ ಇನ್ ಬ್ರೈನ್. ಯು ಡೂ ದ ಬ್ರೀದಿಂಗ್ ಬಿಸ್ನೆಸ್, ಕಾಲ್ ಇನ್ ಲಂಗ್. ಯು ಡೂ ದಿ ಪುಷಿಂಗ್ ಹಾರ್ಟ್ ಬ್ಲಡ್ ಬಿಸ್ನೆಸ್, ಕಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಹಾರ್ಟ್. ಯು ಡೂ ದ ವಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಬಿಸ್ನೆಸ್, ಕಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಆಸ್ ಮಸಲ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಯು ಡೂ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಂಗ್ತ್, ಕಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಆಸ್ ಬೋನ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ಸ್ ಹೌ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅ ಬಾಡಿ. ಟುಡೇ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ದಿಸ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್, ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್. ಎವ್ರಿ ಸೆಲ್ ಎಮಿಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಫೋಟಾನ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ ಲೈಟ್, ವಿಚ್ ಟಿಲ್ ನೌ ಕುಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ಸ್ಟಡೀಡ್. ಬಟ್ ನೌ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಫಿಸಿಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಫಿಟ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಬರ್ಟ್ ಪಾಪ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಿಟ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಬರ್ಟ್ ಪಾಪ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಡಿವೈಸ್ಡ್ ಎ ಫೋಟಾನ್ ಕ್ಯಾಮರಾ, ವೆರಿ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಕ್ಯಾಮರಾ. ಸಿ ದಿಸ್ ಹೌ ದ ಪಿಕ್ಚರ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್. ನೌ ಇಫ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ಸಿಂಕ್, ಇಫ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪಿ ವಿತ್ ವನ್ ಅನದರ್, ದೇ ಆರ್ ಡಾನ್ಸಿಂಗ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್, ಯು ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ಹೆಲ್ದಿ. ವೆನ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿಂಕ್, ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡಿಸೀಸ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಲ್ನೆಸಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಬಾಡಿ. ವೆನ್ ಯು ಟ್ರೀಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೇ ಕಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್, ಯು ಗೆಟ್ ಅ ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಪಿಕ್ಚರ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಫೋಟೋನ್ ಕ್ಯಾಮ್ರಾ. ಸೊ ಫ್ರಿಟ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಬರ್ಟ್ ಪಾಪ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಡಿಫೈನ್ಡ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಆಸ್ ಅ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಪರ್ಫೆಕ್ಟ್ ಸಬ್ಅಟಾಮಿಕ್ ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಕೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಡಿಸೀಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಅ ಬ್ರೇಕ್ ಡೌನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್. ವೆನ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಇಲ್, ಯುವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಔಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸಿಂಕ್. ನೌ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಗಿವ್ ಎ ಸೀಕ್ರೆಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಹೌ ಟು ಬಿ ಹೆಲ್ದಿ. ದೀಸ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಲವ್ ಒನ್ ಅನದರ್. ಡಿಡ್ ಯು ನೋ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ದೇ ಲವ್ ಒನ್ ಅನದರ್ ಸೋ ಮಚ್, ದೇ ಲವ್ ಅದರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಅ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೀ. ಡಿಡ್ ಯು ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್? ಸಿಂಗ್ ಸಾಬ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೀ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ he is a part of the universal consciousness called individual consciousness. I am a part of the same universal consciousness. So if I hurt Singh Saab, I am hurting myself. That is why when I want to say, I want to take this Singh Saab from his chair, I want to sit in that chair, then myself get confused. What is this BM Hegde fool doing? He is hating his own body. So after some time, if I keep on doing that, my own cells hate my own cells. Autoimmune disease. Horror, auto, toxicus, Paul Ehrlich said. See how interesting it is? And this is very interesting. Now we have changed the definition of health. And with this, we went to the IOM, Institute of Medicine. And the Institute of Medicine now has accepted the word WP, whole body, whole person healing, WPH, as the future of medicine, WPH. 20th February 2010. The meeting of the IOM in Washington, they accepted this and it's coming. So I have defined health as, health is enthusiasm to work and enthusiasm to be universally compassionate. Health is enthusiasm to work and enthusiasm to love, Richard Smith of BMJ. And need a new definition of health, said Fiona. And health is work and love, said Freud. Now completely it's changed. It's very easy to know whether you're healthy or not. I always tell people, if you're healthy, don't see a doctor. If you want honor, don't go to the police. If you want justice, don't go to the court. But if you are not well, go and see a doctor. Even if it is headache, see a doctor. Not necessarily that you should take his medicine, but see a doctor, find out what it is, and discuss with him. Be a partner in your treatment. And if somebody hits you, then go to the police and say, he hit me, you know, just protect me. And if somebody has done injustice, you could go to the court. But going to a doctor when you are healthy is the most dangerous thing that you can do, is an article in the British Medical Journal. I have written it earlier, but British Medical Journal writes that. Read that. So I always tell people, don't go to see a doctor when you are well. Then they say, how do I know I am well? Ayurveda says so beautifully. Samadhatuhu, samagnischa, samadoshaha, malakriha, prasannatma indriya manaha swastha itya vidyate. You shit well, you eat well, you piss well, you sleep well, and you have enthusiasm to work, and you don't hate nobody, you are healthy. So in the morning you get up and say, do I want to go to the department today? If the answer is yes, you are healthy. Then in the review, see, do I have to do help others in the department? If the answer is yes, you are terribly healthy. That is very interesting. Okay, I'll come back. Human metagenome. NIH has been working on metagenome for the last 10 years without telling anybody. They didn't tell our geneticists here. They quietly worked because they said, we will get the metagenome first and teach all these slaves, we make money and teach them. But unfortunately, they found $100 million, 10 years of work, the whole of NIH, which is called the palace, they got only 10 genes. So they said, no. If the whole world's laboratories work on genetics only, 24 hours of the day for the next 100 years, we will probably not be able to unravel the metagenome because 3 trillion, not one or million or billion, genes are there in your gene. So for every one cell in your body, 9 cells are germs. So germs are us. Toys are us, you have seen the shop. Germs are us. And you see, you read my article in the BMJ, germs are us. Now we are germs. So you can't be proud. I am so and so. No. You can't even lift its finger without the permission of the E. coli or somebody. And the latest treatment for dying patients with infections, no antibiotic cures. Do you know the latest treatment? Good human feces. Healthy human feces. 250 cc, emulsified, put in a Ryle's tube in. 4 hours later, the patient will go home. Americans call it as fecal transplant. So you accept it. Oh, yes, yes, fecal transplant. I'm accepting it. If I told you, now I was watching your faces, you're making some grimacing face. Like that. When I said fecal transplant, everybody's bright. Because Johns Hopkins, it comes from Johns Hopkins. Barbara Starfield has done that and saved a lot of patients with difficile infection, Clostridium difficile. A silly germ kills people in the intensive care unit. So now it has become an accepted fact. Murarji Desai drinks urine, he says, But when it comes from the West, auto urine therapy is very good because it improves your immune system. You read that paper in the PubMed and say, that's right. See? Cow's urine, like that. Cow's colostrum has come as immune suppressed drug, and one tablet is $10. So he says, it's good. It's very good because it's come from America. Our slavish mentality is you want an American stamp for everything or a British stamp. Anything Indian? I want the physiology department in every college to buy this book. Every department. This is called Body Electric. This man must be venerated. He must be given not one Nobel Prize, but two. But he was demonized. This man showed that every human cell is a semiconductor. And he showed that energy, electric energy, can cure things like even cancer. His name is Robert Becker. Bob, or Robert Becker, was the professor of orthopedics in the New York State University in the 1950s. For 20 years, he did so much of research, but he was demonized. His professorship was removed. They were about to take his degree out, like that Wakeley fellow, and then they were thrown on the road, but he survived. He's no more. May his soul rest in peace. But this book, every physiologist must read, The Electromagnetism and the Foundation of Life. Foundation of Life. And I am working with one of his associates. I'll show you something. All of you know water, right? Who doesn't know water? I drank it just now. That is water, no? This is what you studied. H-H-O. No. Water is something very live. This is water. This is the water structure. What a complicated structure with a lot of loose bonds here and there. A lot of loose bonds, very hungry for anything. So what we did, we put nano silver particles in these loose bonds and got some nano silver water, simple nano silver water. It's water with some nano silver particles. It's very simple to do that. Might cost about 5 rupees a bottle, big bottle. You take 15 ml of that 3 times a day, malaria gets cured in 3 days. Dengue, anything. And I have been running after this, the great government people, anybody is there in authority. I didn't get permission. So I had to go to Africa to do a study. We did 100 patients. 100 patients survived. Not statistical science. 100 patients survived. And we have published that. Even then, but nobody bothers. Nobody bothers. But the companies are after your blood because they can't sell antibiotics. Antibiotics produce resistance. This doesn't. because it doesn't kill the germs the way you think it does. Very interesting. Now, but more than that, this is a live structure. Very interesting. It flows by whirling only. Water does not flow by lamination. Laminar flow does not exist in water. Water is alive. If you see water going up a tree, you pour the water at the bottom, the tree goes up and the water goes up. So beautiful. You must know when they magnify it and show you, water is so just going. And then finds a crevice, it goes there. And somewhere it goes. It goes to the tree top. So we did something with water. This what is this? Now physiology. This was your heart when you were in the mother's womb. There were no heart. It was two dorsal vessels. Now you all teach your students, heart pumps blood across the right. Right or wrong? Correct, no? If the heart were to pump blood, think for a little while. If the heart were to pump blood, you wouldn't be here at all. Because you didn't have a heart for 20 weeks in the mother's womb. Who pumped blood? Now the madam is saying, You didn't think about it earlier. No, now you think. Now I want you to think something more. And that is, this water is very interesting. Very, very interesting. And that water keeps you alive. Now these two tubes, your own passing water, that is water is blood. But unfortunately, blood is not just water. Blood has colloids and suspensoids. What are colloids? You all know, right? Electrical charge atoms, which are either anions, anion means one extra electron, or cations, one electron less. Now, very interestingly, this is how you are living, because the cations, same, they, you know, repel each other. The anions repel each other, so your blood doesn't clot. Now, if the blood clots and you die of a heart attack, do you know our treatment? We give rat poison, warfarin. Warfarin is rat poison. Did you know that? The same poison you give a rat, you give in a small dose to a man. No, you don't have to do that. You will have to just drink water with a different pH. You can alter the pH of water and drink the mixture of water. Then the anions and the cations get activated. They'll never clot inside the vessel. Clotting has to happen only when the vessel breaks. But inside the vessel, if you have to clot, your blood has become very thick. You've eaten so much and you have not drunk water at all. And the water you drink is not the right variety. If you drink the water here, this is just, what is this? Chlorine. You just boil this water and drink it, you really get chlorine smell. And you call it as mineral water. You pay 90 rupees in a 5-star hotel. So what does the heart do? Have you seen this? Bathtub, you have seen it, bathed in it, but not observed it. Today you go to your hotel, let some water there, put the stopcock. And when the water is to a certain level, stop the water, pull the stopcock, watch the water. It goes, you don't see it. When the end comes, boom, that's called whirling. And the whirling gives it energy, and that energy makes the water flow. So in the human body also, the heart cannot pump blood. It's a 300-gram muscular structure. And you have 8 lakhs kilometers of capillaries into which even an RBC cannot flow easily. So it requires 142 horsepower for one pumping. So first pumping itself, the patient will die. So you're all alive here. That means it's not pumping. What does the heart do? Have you seen anatomies here? Heart muscle is a peculiar structure. It's got a twisted muscle. It's called Hegde-Pigledy muscular. So what does the heart do? It gives it a twist. So from the swimming pool, through the veins, the blood is sucked into the heart. Does not flow, it is sucked positively into the heart. And then it gives a twist and it moves on to the artery. And then with whirling it goes. I'll show you. See, this inside the vessel, if you see, this is how it flows. Not laminarly. You're teaching your students laminar flow of blood. If you really understand laminar flow, the outer lamina doesn't flow at all. The inner lamina flows a little faster, innermost fastest. Now you give a vasodilator for lowering the blood pressure. What happens? Nothing happens. Only the inner core runs a little faster and kills somebody. That's all what happens. This is very interesting. It should have come first. This slide came later. Recently, somebody did 3,000 original studies in medicine to show what we are doing to the patients. See that? More than half, 60%, are not of no known effectiveness at all. And the beneficial is only 3%. Can you believe that? 3%. That means 97% of the patients, you send them to meet their maker in heaven. How many of you have heard the science of rheology? Good, good, good. It's a new branch of physics. Rheology deals with the fluid flow. And if you know rheology, you will forget Newton's laws of deterministic spread, equally gravity, blah, 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 blah. You put liquid helium in a bottle, not bottle, a bowl, and keep it on a table. Liquid helium. And you will watch it. The second day, the helium starts coming up. There's a little helium at the bottom, liquid helium. It comes up, goes up, walks up, walks up, goes to the brim, and falls down. You hold liquid helium in a silicon bottle and hold it up. Leave it there. 24 hours later, this helium leaks through the silicon bottle. No holes there. Aayye Sardarji, idhar hai, aapke liye rakha hai. Aayye. Idhar aayye. Tashrif rakhe. Aayye, idhar aayye. We welcome all the, you know, I know the airport is so far away in Bangalore, it's inhuman because, you know, even if you land on time, it takes about an hour and a half, nearly 2 hours to come here. We were just talking about rheology, sir. So all the gravity, you know, that you mugged up for passing your intermediate physics or PUC physics, you should forget it now. Now in the PUC, teachers teach you something in physics. Even when I was a student, they were teaching. Laminar flow in a tube cannot produce lateral pressure because if it produces lateral pressure, it can't flow further. Cosine 90 is zero. So I mugged it up. Otherwise, I won't go to the medical college. Mugged it up. Went to the physiology class. Then Sarada Subramaniam said, blood pressure is a lateral pressure exerted on the vessel wall by the flowing blood. I mugged it up. I had forgotten what my teacher taught in physics. Now I'm saying blood pressure is the lateral pressure exerted on the vessel wall by the flowing blood. If it flows really pressure at lateral pressure, it can't flow. And if it is a laminar flow, it's okay. But it's a whirling flow. See? So what is blood pressure? God only knows. I'm supposed to be doing research on blood pressure for 40 years. I've written a book on blood pressure. Now if you ask me, I don't know what blood pressure is. This rheology is the flow depends on the kind of fluid inside. You see the honey? You drop the honey, it just doesn't settle like water. It settles, there's a little peak there, and then you leave it, it settles down. That is why in America, the honey bottle dispensers are different. In our bottle, you take and then eat it and keep it. The honey goes all over the place and then ants come. This madam knows that. She was troubled by the ants. Now, this is rheology. See now, this is the blood vessel, the real human blood vessel, how blood is flowing. Seeing this also, they say, again go and teach, flowing blood in the laminar flow, there's lateral pressure. Now see, how the flow depends only on shear stress, on systolic pressure, diastolic pressure, what have you, depends on suspensoids and colloids. Suspensoids are RBCs, WBCs, this, that, and things like that. Colloids are anions, cations, etc., etc. Of course, there are crystalloids. That's a different thing. A lot of things, and not just the... Now, we all taught Starling's laws. And do you know what Starling said? Heart is a peculiar structure. I did vivisection, dissected, did not understand how the heart functions. Now I think I'll confine myself to systole, which I can understand, and forget about diastole. He wrote that, but you teach systole is active, diastole is passive, nothing happens in diastole, blood simply comes back. But Narayana Suktani, Dasha Suktani, 10,000 years ago wrote, beautifully wrote. It wrote, the heart is like a lotus bud kept upside down with the tip slightly to the left. And at the root arises a huge stalk which takes God's energy to all parts of the body. How true it is in physics today? It is the energy of rheology, energy of whirling that takes blood to every corner of your body. Otherwise, you and I will not be alive. Now we know a New York surgeon, incidentally, he's an Indian-born New York surgeon, a venologist has shown that if you inject a little dye into the vein, the dye jumps from one vein valve to another vein valve. It's called venous dance. He calls it as venous dance. Jumps. And it's sucked into the atrium. And this is called the venous dance. And eventually, it comes to the right atrium. This is now published. He has published it just last year. He has been working for 10 years. And this boy is from Bangalore Medical College. So they transplant it to a vein here. And in 2 months' time, the leg is normal. Now you go to a doctor, and in the physiology class you teach, the ECG is regular sinus rhythm, absolute, right, no? Right? If it is really regular, you are dead. In real physiology, rhythmia is death, arrhythmia is health. And this is your heart. This is a healthy heart. And we have been studying this for the last 25 years. And this is what we used to do in the olden days. Of course, first I started with medical students and ordinary polygraphs. So I used to have x-axis your heart rate, y-axis your heart rate delayed slightly mathematically. And then see how, now of course we do it on a computer, and see how now this is your heart rate. This is your own heart rate with a mathematical delay. You see how it is a chaotic thing? This is called healthy chaos. So everything in the human body is dynamic. Blood pressure goes up and down like that. You catch it here, you go high blood pressure. Catch it here, you go low blood pressure. There's nothing called blood pressure like that, except when you're dead. Blood sugar is like this. It's not steady. We did a study, very interesting study. We pricked 10 fingers of medical students with 10 minutes. In 10 minutes, you prick 10 fingers and study the blood sugar. If all the 10 readings are identical, either he is a very bad diabetic or he's going to be a diabetic. But if the 10 readings are 10 different readings, he will never be a diabetic in his life. He has got a healthy chaos. This applies to blood pressure also. A lot of patients come. Sir, I came yesterday, it was 122, and today it is 120, sir. So that must be something very seriously wrong. I said, very seriously wrong, because you're alive. And there are doctors who get 125 blood pressure. Have you seen that? There is no 5 in that box. They invented a 5. That box was invented by the Riva Rossi, Stipone Riva Rossi. That fellow, I am told, is turning in his grave saying that the abuse and the misuse these doctors put it into is something phenomenal, and they killed millions. I have published a study just about 2 months ago, 1,000 medical students. What we did was we checked their blood pressure and then frightened them. Next checking, it goes up. Check their blood pressure, and then other limb, you put a tourniquet and block the brachial artery, blood pressure goes up. Just check the blood pressure as we do, push, and then it push, it goes up. And then you search for a stethoscope, it's paining. He says, hurting, sir. Blood pressure has gone up to the sky. You want that because everybody is labeled hypertensive. This is called white coat hypertension. Now see this patient. This fellow's heart rate doesn't move at all. He's very steady, like the physiology class. Regular heart rate. He was dead in 2 hours. Now over the years, what we have done is, we have put a CWT pattern. It's a computer thing, very mathematical, don't worry about it. What I want to see is, I want you to see this picture. You see this, This is a healthy heart. Now if you see the same heart that I showed you, and see the pattern, this is CW, a continuous wavelet transform. It's a very complicated mathematics, don't worry about that. But look at the picture, it's a healthy heart. Look at this heart rate, this is a healthy heart. Now go to this heart, see, it's absolutely regular. All the pumpkins are in one row. And this patient is dead in no time. You are a human cell. That's what I want you to concentrate on. This is a human cell. The most important part of the human cell is the cell wall. All this bilipid, etc., you mugged it in the book. All that I want you to see is this. This is the integral membrane protein which conducts things from inside and outside. But these antennae are there. The day you are made in your mother's womb, you are a zygote, one cell, one cell. That one cell is you today. 1 trillion, 100 trillion cells. That one cell had this antenna, and this antenna gets this message from the universal consciousness. You are born. The day this antenna stops receiving it, you are dead. Did you understand that? An anatomist studied this. See? Anatomist did not study dead body. He studied live cells. His name is Bruce Lipton, professor of cellular biology in the Massachusetts Medical School. What did he do? He put this inside in a live media and then studied it. Did not even go out of the room, electron microscope room, studied. And he found things happening. He found the cell becoming live. And Bruce was an atheist, agnostic. When he saw the cell becoming live, he completely converted. He became, oh, there is something beyond man. Up until then, he thought man is running the whole thing. You know, as professor of anatomy, he was running the whole world. Then he realized, no, I'm not running it. Someone else is running it. Then he realized that human life is like the television screen. You put the switch on, Hema Malini is dancing. Then you switch off, Hema Malini is dead. Hema Malini is not in the box, but Hema Malini is waves, energy waves for a dancer in the box. Now that same wave, you put go to another room and switch it on, she is dancing there. Same thing happens to you. Dying is the switch connection goes off and immediately connects to another cell, another zygote. When he knew this, he wrote a book for you. Biology of Belief. Read this book, Biology of Belief. Bruce Lipton is the name. Lipton, T, you know, T. Bruce, add to that. It's a fascinating book. And then there is another girl who was doing a lot of work in this area. And she was, of course, she was to get the Nobel Prize. Her boss got the Nobel Prize. This is how, what happens, you know. You write the paper and the boss gets the first. This is what happened to her also. Saul Snyder, her name is Candace Pert. But she, of course, fought. She went to the Nobel Committee, showed her work and showed them. And his Nobel Prize was withdrawn. But this girl has written a book for you called Emo Molecules of Emotion. It's a fascinating book. Nice book. Molecules of Emotion. Author's name is Candace, C-A-N-D-A-C-E, Pert, P-E-R-T. And this girl's book is very good. Now then come, this is how the ligand, the connection comes. This is the girl, Candace. This is Bruce. Now we come back to what work we are doing on this area of holistic medicine. We took this, one of my colleagues was the greatest scientist the world had ever known. He was nominated for the Nobel 21 times, but they denied him the Nobel. His students, two of his students got Nobel. He didn't get it because he praises Indian things and so he doesn't get it. He's an American. He converted himself to Christianity and lives in America with an American wife. Now, of course, he's dead. He's 89. May his soul rest in peace. His name is Rustum Roy. He was the man who was invited by the government of India to study the science institutions here and he told them all of them need to be completely revamped. Now, he took this from the Rigveda. Rigveda has this stolen clone, Urj. Do you know what it says in short? Water is the mother of fire. Water is the mother, father of fire. Agni. All energy comes from water. And so we said, let us see. So this is a silver mesh, and we put water on that, and silver nanoparticles get deposited. And we wanted to convert man into a salamander. You cut the salamander's tail. Have you seen that? Palli, palli, at home. It grows. Your tail also grows if you cut. But only thing is, salamander can do it on its own. For you, we have to help it. Now, this boy lost his fingertip. He lost his fingertip on 16th May 1995 in a machine. It went off. He didn't have money to re-suture it. So what we did was we covered it with a silver thing and put some water and changed the polarity from negative to positive with the 9.9 volt battery. See, on the third day, it is so clean. No infection. Nobody has touched it. And after a month, it started growing. After another month, it started growing. Now it has completely grown into a finger. And if you want to know what it was like that. Here is a police retired IG in Madras. This is his foot, diabetic foot. And they wanted to chop it off. The man refused because he said, if you chop off the foot when you're alive, next janma you will not have a foot itself, it seems, according to him. You and I don't believe it. We laugh at it. But he believed it. He wanted to die with it. So ultimately, there was a good surgeon called Murli. I told Murli, you clean it. Let us see. He cleaned it. So we cleaned it. And then did our trick. The man has a foot, complete foot, normal foot. Not only that, watch this. This is the foot. Diabetic foot is always very fat. Because growth, insulin is growth hormone. Hyperinsulinemia. You see, the foot has become normal. This lady is here in the audience, sitting there. She came to me with blocks everywhere. Every vessel is blocked. Blood pressure 240, 140, etc., etc. And see this complete block at the abdominal aorta just after the renal artery has taken off. So I have the same device, put it here. She is walking now. And she is very fine. But what happened? After 3 months, you see, like a horse tail, lot of new vessels have grown. And the runoff is so good. She has a very good femoral artery. Her blood pressure has come down. Her stroke has recovered. And she didn't have a heart attack because she was told that she will have a heart attack because all the vessels are blocked. And she is fine and walking about, all because her husband believed in what we did. And he didn't go for 4 bypass surgeries in the heart, in the neck, in the leg, in the abdomen. She would have been with her maker by now. This is a very famous film actress in, not film actress, dancer in Madras. She, her disc was removed by 44 lakhs operation in a 5-star corporate hospital. Then she was in the wheelchair all the time. And she was crying. So anyway, now she is dancing. So what has happened? Medicalization of society. We are pushing people into the bottomless pit by giving our treatment. But all that we did has no impact on society because whether you treat them or don't treat them, the curve is the same. It has only shifted a little because you have sent them a little early to the other world. See here, this is 17 studies of blood pressure treatment in the world, starting from the original MRC study of mild to moderate hypertension, the European study, the Australasian study, and now come to every study, EWPST and everything. And all the studies together showed that relative risk reduction is very good. But absolute risk reduction is hardly anything. You know the two things, relative risk reduction and absolute risk reduction? You don't know. Very interesting. We fool people in the paper showing only the relative risk reduction. We don't tell them about absolute risk reduction. I have treated 100 patients. 5 of them survived. 10 should have died, but only 5 died. So I have reduced the risk by 50%. My statistical estimate is this group of patients, I predict 10% must die. I have given the treatment, only 5% died. So 50% reduction. That's called relative risk reduction, RRR. If you took absolute risk reduction, you have done nothing. So all these blood pressure trial errors have showed that you did nothing. What helped them is change of mode of living. Tranquility of mind, food and moderation, and proper diet, and they all survive, and have, irrespective of what the blood pressure is. Come now. We say, we have controlled all the infections. Long before we even came on the scene, infections had almost disappeared. There are better graphs than this. This one graph I have showed you, how even before the BCG had come, tuberculosis had almost come to that level. But now, from 1900, tuberculosis is going up. India is the most dangerous country because 9% primary resistance of tuberculosis. Bus, taxi, anywhere you can get TB. This is incidence of TB going up globally. We say we have a very good, we have treatment, we have this, we have DOT, we have this and sanatorium and all. This is a fantastic study. They took 5,000 Swedish men and then told them, one group, you told them do what you like, their control group. The other group, they were told, come to us, free, we will give you treatment for everything and we'll correct everything. So you see, after 15 years, 3 times more people died in the intervened group. The control group are very happy going about. Then somebody said, okay, that is all total death, but heart death would have certainly come. See, heart death. Twice the number of people died in the intervened group. Blood pressure, you must control it. Otherwise, you know, it's the silent killer will kill everybody. And we have been killing people after 5 years of treating blood pressure. Now, this is our effort for the last about 15 years, and Professor Rustum Roy was the founder, and we have been able to get it. This is a journal, and this my co-editor-in-chief is the Professor Rustum Roy. He was in the beginning till he died. Then now Hans-Peter Dior, Nobel Prize, Emeritus Director, Max Planck Institute. And this is Hans-Peter Dior. He's 86. He came over 2 months ago here, lectured. Now this is the editorial board. You see the who is who in the world of science all over the world. And this is the first editorial board. Rustum Roy here. Joey Jones, one of the greatest cancer surgeons who does not treat cancer with his treatment, but with chronic healing. And our friend, Hans-Peter Dior. Friends, we are in the ne plus ultra stage. We know everything. There's nothing beyond us. So we have our study, our publications, everything. That was the Spanish flag before America was discovered. Ne plus ultra was their choice. Like Satyameva Jayate, which is also not true. Anratameva Jayate na Satyam. That's what's happening in India. Now come to the flag now. After Columbus discovered America, they knew there's something more. So they removed that ne. They call it as plus ultra, more beyond. So friends, science has to go from ne plus ultra to plus ultra. Thank you very much.